Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you all to this celebration of ALST Day. Yay! I'm Mary Moran. I'm the interim director of Africana and Latin American Studies, ALST Day. And this event, whether you came here for it or not, is Soup in the Coop with Spoken Word. And we will have a variety of Africana and Latin American Studies faculty and students entertaining you with spoken word, poems, stories, performances, while you enjoy your soup. We also want to remind everyone that the big event of ALST Day is the Du Bois Lecture, named for W.E.B. and Shirley Graham Du Bois, who many, at least W.E.B. Du Bois, many of you encountered in Core 152, we hope. And the lecture will be given this afternoon at 4:30 in Person Auditorium by Michelle Moyd, who is a historian from Indiana University, one of very few people in the country doing research on the role of Africa in World War I. It's kind of a blank spot in the history books, and she is filling it. So come and enjoy the lecture at 4:30. What I've chosen to read is related to my own research. I'm an anthropologist, a cultural anthropologist in the SOAN department, and my field work is in a small West African country called Liberia. And some of you may have heard of Liberia because of the Ebola outbreak a few years ago. Some of you may know of its historical connection to the United States, and some of you may even know that it suffered through a very long civil war. The poet I'm going to read to you from today is a woman named Patricia Jaba Wesley. She is ethnically Grebo, which is the group of people I work with in southeastern Liberia, and she is a professor of English at Penn State and a widely published and prize-winning poet. And some of the poems I'm going to read reference her experience during the Civil War. Some of the ones I've chosen reference her experience as an African academic in the United States, raising a family here, living in a diaspora. Okay? So I hope you enjoy the selections I've made. This one is called Elegy for Desi, and if any of you have read Chimamanda Adichie's Americana, this kind of reminds me of that experience of Africans navigating life in the United States. My telephone rang in the news at 10:30, your news arriving through a cordless phone. The day outside my window came in uninvited. Snowflakes sparkling, falling in silver pieces here in Kalamazoo. Such an uncommitted day it was, Desi. January is not the time to die here in America. In Monrovia, we would have marched you in the Harmattan winds, moist air from the Atlantic, sweeping grave dirt away so you could go down. Now, all over America, telephones must be ringing in the news that Desi Webster has just died. Will a friend somewhere pick up the phone today in Monrovia, London, Accra, Abidjan, Sino, and break the news to some man or woman and run and tell someone, human answering machines holding the news for us all? All over the world, your friends will have to make way for you now, to hold up an hour for you now. I stood there at the window after that cruel phone call, thinking of you in college. Everyone used to talk about you as if you were the legend for younger girls to live. They say it was New York that killed you. that you must have wandered into its glitter at night and lost your own glitter, all your innocence and faith gone. Friends who used to love you no longer loved you after that. Isn't that something, Desi? When you called last October to tell us that you were going to die soon, apologizing for dying on us, and then too, beside me on the couch, held on to the other phone while I begged you not to die. Jesus, how does a woman like you die? You who knew how to take life unawares. Remember how you sent for us in 1993 so we could see where you lived in Queens? Your car slipping in and out of the Manhattan traffic as though you owned the streets and the city, as though you created the city with your own hands. On Saturday, I saw you rise at dawn and set the house all smoking with home cooking. Palm butter and rice, cassava and gravy, fufu and soup, chicken fried deep and hot. One moment you were laughing, one moment you were banging pots and dishes. At noon, there were your guests, old friends from back home, new New Yorkers, sitting and talking in your backyard, as if they truly loved you. Maybe they truly loved you, Desi. I stood at your upstairs window each day at dawn to see your city, to watch your town rise with the speed of a jet. If I could know New York, I could know you, I told myself. Did you bring us over to New York so we could keep you forever? Thank you. So here's another one that describes the experience of Patricia Jabba Wesley and her husband, Lentu Wesley, during the war. They had both been university professors at the University of Liberia in the capital, Monrovia. And then they found themselves suddenly, along with hundreds of thousands of other Liberians, just another displaced family in a refugee camp when the war swept through the city. So this poem is called For My Husband. We lived through rationed minutes at Seoul Clinic Mission Displaced Center on rationed grains and fear. And then night visited its shadows despite the odorous air from the killing rubber bush. One day I asked you if you were sure this was still Liberia. You looked at me and said, "It's okay, my wife, it's okay." Our children, ill and starving, pleading for milk, for a candy bar, for bread and meat, for a birthday gift and cake. And we looked at each other and sighed, knowing what children do not know. There were no mirrors, no wardrobes, no salons where we girls knew how to spend a whole day braiding or relaxing long dark hair amidst the chattering room of girls, working my long dark hair so I could let it loose the way I used to let it loose. How I used to twist and turn for you to see my new hairdo. Now with no shaving blades or perfume soap, no perfumes or nail polish, no iron or clothes to iron. Today you looked at me and said how beautiful I had become in the war. And when the night came, we fell asleep, listening to shooting outside. You said you loved me, even though you saw what I did not see. And sitting in the crowded camp, we held hands tight, waiting, praying. I said I loved you while I saw what you did not see. All the bones of our jaws and chests piercing through flabby flesh, we had become bones, eyes, and skin. But we did not know and didn't wish to know. I had lost my lipstick or couldn't recall if I had ever had lipstick. And when we ate cooked green papayas for potatoes, the heart of palm trees for meat, craw-craw crabs for seafood, we shut our eyes tight, laughing at ourselves. We were the lucky ones with no mirrors in the war. We were the lucky ones with eyes to see the smoke, to see the missiles flying toward what used to be home. Breathing in air from the dead. We waited to see if the food would kill us before the rebels could kill us. We ate leaves we did not know we could eat. We ate anyway and lived through eating. We tried this or that to see if we would not die from eating this or that. We made laughter we did not know we had. Did we learn to sleep on cold floors, laughing at ourselves over and over? Our new eating habits, our new bathing habits, our new songs, days handed to us in brief interrupted installments. We were becoming new people, we told ourselves. At night, we went to sleep knowing how far away tomorrow was. Often, I looked to see if you'd catch me smiling the way I caught you smiling. Here's another one about the war years called Small Desires. We had become small desires, a few cups of rice to feed a family of 10, no salt, no sugar, no oil or beans, just a few pounds of raw white rice to feed those who might be dead tomorrow. Refugees desiring a place to wait and take in small air. If you ask me about the mother awakened by tomorrow's needs at 2 a.m, I'd say, the ceiling is her company and the crickets outdoors. Her children are asleep while the old clock ticks hard about the house. Silence has a voice. And the woman lies still in bed. Is she content to have a bed? No bombing, no shooting? The poor of the world have small desires. A loaf of bread, a pound of rice, a few small fish, food for today, a few tablets to heal an ailing child, fresh water to drink, a spot to lay the head. The baby Jesus was laid on a bed of odorous hay. Small wishes don't have legs or arms, just the heart's soft beats. 3 children, my husband and I, are clinging to 1 small suitcase after the war. We are standing at O'Hare, amid suitcases banging. It is Welcome to America Day. To be alive still is such a matter for dancing. Dan Densk is here at O'Hare with jackets, boots, hugs, tears. All our years before the war come rushing amidst this airport, and my eyes refuse to look on the years in my eyes. To have a friend like Daniel Densk standing here and a place to hide now is all there is to this life. And when tomorrow is settled, there are a few small things the war can teach us. To eat the non-edibles of this life, wild crabs, green papayas, in place of bread, bamboo shoots for fish, beans as if beans were potatoes. Displacement is not a matter of will. Finding a place to hide is reason for dancing, no shouting. Those who must hide cannot give away their hiding place. And I have one more. Do you want to hear one more? Okay. This one speaks to the pressures that many immigrants are on from feel from their families back home sometimes. It's called A Poem for My Father. Pa wants another degree from me, a PhD for sure. Me, his oldest girl child who was supposed to be a man. As if God won't let Pa into heaven without a family PhD. Won't listen to Pa's old arguments about too many children plus too many hungry relatives to feed. Too many mats to put down, and all those relatives from Callaway arriving, red with dust, from 2 days' dusty highway. Heavy loads of palm nuts, red palm oil, bags of cassava, potatoes, eddos, all that rice, pounded so white you can see right through each grain. You see, we all know how that rice was pounded just for each trip. Relatives coming with dried bushmeat, smoked dry like a rock. All those loads of food coming to our door at dawn, a truck's old engine beating leaded gasoline to help pollute our already polluted earth. The cost of bringing all that foodstuff through 500 miles of rocky, hilly country roads of Grand Jita, Nimba, Bong. All this trouble for nothing, since the loads are for some other relatives who cannot afford to pay the truck driver's fare. But Pa is the town's big book man, pays everyone's debt, marries up everyone's daughter, and when they die, Pa pays the gravedigger, the dirge singer, puts the bronze on every casket, the black on every lapa, gin for the morning table, feeds the women on the mat, so the burial is merry, and the dead stand proud. Pa buys the kola nuts to chew, meets up the soup, and so the mat goes wild. And that's why I'm back in school after all these years. In all the homesickness and the snow, Pa says, get that PhD before I die, before they lay me in this earth. If I don't, the ground beneath my feet will rock. My feet will slip and slide under my father's turning over and over in his soggy grave. The whole earth will open under my feet. A house or two may tumble, rock and fall to the ground, opening up its wide mouth to swallow me up. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alicia Simmons. I am your friendly African American Studies coordinator. I'm also an assistant professor, or associate professor, in sociology and anthropology. And so today I brought two things to read. In thinking about W.E.B. Du Bois, who our lecture is named after, I know that many of you have encountered him in 152, but I'm curious about how much you've learned. And so I want to give a brief biography of Du Bois, and then I'll read one of my favorite of his works on agitation. So to begin, just to fill you in on what Du Bois is about, William Edward Burghardt Du Bois was born in Great Barrington, Massachusetts on February 23, 1868. He died in Accra, Ghana on August 27, 1963. The mere dates of his lifespan are cause to pause. He was born just after the Civil War, and he died as the Vietnam War was well underway. He was born when Tchaikovsky was beginning to compose his classical orchestral works, and he died as the Beatles' early hits were topping the pop charts. He was born a few years after the defeat of slavery, and he died the night before Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his famous "I Have a Dream" speech at the nation's capital. He was born before the invention of the telephone, and he died when transcontinental airplanes were flying regularly all over the world. He was born before the invention of the electric light bulb, and he died at a time when astronauts were orbiting the Earth in space. He was born just after the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and he died the year of John F. Kennedy's assassination. Few individuals have lived through a greater period of historical, cultural, and technological change. He married Nina Gomer in 1896, and they had two children, a son, Burghardt, and a daughter, Yolande. A year after Nina's death in 1950, he married his second wife, Shirley Graham. Du Bois received a BA in 1888 from Fisk University, a second BA from Harvard in 1890, and an MA from Harvard in 1892. After 2 years of study at the University of Berlin, he received his PhD from Harvard in 1895. He was professor of Greek and Latin at Wilberforce University from 1894 to 1896. Assistant instructor of sociology at the University of Pennsylvania from 1896 to 1897, and at Atlanta University, he was professor of economics and history from 1897 to 1910, and chairman of the sociology department there from 1934 to 1944. Du Bois was a prolific writer, publishing more than 20 books and thousands of essays and articles throughout his life. He wrote regularly for the New York Age, the New York Amsterdam News, and the Springfield Republican. He was editor of The Moon in 1906, editor of The Horizon from 1907 to 1910, editor of The Crisis from 1910 till 1934, and editor of Phylon from 1940 to 1944. In addition to his scholarship, he also expressed himself creatively, writing novels as well as poetry. On top of his work as a teacher and scholar, he was a tireless activist for social and racial justice. He was the principal founder of the Niagara Movement and served as its general secretary. He was a prominent founder of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and served as its chairman for many years. He publicly fought against lynching, discrimination, and colonial exploitation. He was a world leader of the Pan-African movement, serving as secretary of the first Pan-African Congress, and was a leader of many subsequent Pan-African Congresses. A socialist and later a communist, he fought for women's rights, Jewish rights, and workers' rights. Not only was he a principal architect of the civil rights movement, but he also supported the arts and various critical cultural expressions as founder of the American Negro Academy and one of the supporting pillars of the Harlem Renaissance. Given such credentials, it comes as no surprise that W.E.B. Du Bois has been recognized by many as an influential cultural and intellectual giant of the 20th century. However, although he has been widely praised as a political leader of the African American community and a noted man of many letters, his reputation as a founding sociologist and penetrating social theorist has been distinctly muted. So Du Bois is great, and don't worry, ALST has plenty of things to talk about in regard to his greatness. And so as a testament to his greatness, I will read my favorite of his essays, The Value of Agitation. This was published in 1907 in The Voice of the Negro, Volume 4. There are those people in the world who object to agitation, and one cannot wholly blame them. Agitation, after all, is unpleasant. It means that while you are going on peaceably and joyfully on your way, some half-mad person insists upon saying things that you do not like to hear. They may be true, but you do not like to hear them. You would rather wait till some convenient season, or you take up your newspaper instead of finding pleasant notices about your friends and the present progress of the world. You read some of the restless folks who insist on talking about wrong and crime and unpleasant things. It would be much better if we did not have to have agitation, if we had a world where everything was going so well that it was unnecessary often to protest strongly, even wildly, of evil and the wrong in the universe. As a matter of fact, however, no matter how unpleasant the agitator is, and no matter how inconvenient and unreasonable his talk, yet we must ever have him with us. And why? Because this is a world where things are not all right. We are gifted with human nature, which does not do right or even desire the right always. So long as these things are true, then we are faced by this dilemma. Either we must let the evil alone and refuse to hear of it or listen to it, or we must try to right it. Now, very often it happens that the evil is there, the wrong has been done, and yet we do not hear of it. We do not know about it. Here then comes the agitator. He is the herald, he is the prophet, he is the man that says to the world, there are evils which you do not know, but which I know, and you must listen to them. Now, of course, there may be agitators who are telling the truth, and there may be agitators who are telling untruths. Those who are not telling the truth may be lying, or they may be mistaken. So that agitation in and of itself does not necessarily mean always right and always reform. Here then is someone who thinks that he has discovered some dangerous evil and wants to call attention of good men of the world to it. If he does not persevere, we may perhaps pass him by, think that the evil which he thought he had saw was cured. But if he is sincere, and if he is persistent, then there is but one thing for a person to do who wants to live in a world worth living in. That is, listen to him carefully, prove his tale, and then try to right the wrong. If we remember the history of all great reform movements, we must remember that they have been preceded by agitation. Take, for instance, the suppression of the slave trade. It was in a day when slavery could not be successfully attacked, but there was no doubt of the horrors of the slave trade. The best and worst of people alike admitted that. Here came a young man just graduated from college. By writing a prize essay, he found himself interested in this great evil. He began to know and learn of things which other people did not know. Not that they knew nothing about them, but they had not brought together all the facts. One isolated person knew the fact, and one knew this fact, but no one person knew both facts in juxtaposition. When they did become acquainted with all the facts, he was sure that they must be moved to act. What then must he do? He must agitate. It was not pleasant. It was putting himself in jeopardy. He was called upon to lose friends, and in some cases, and in all cases, to make himself unpleasant, insistent, persistent, telling of things that people did not want to hear about because they were not interested in them. He must interest people in the things in which they were not interested before, which is a hard task in this busy world. And yet, nevertheless, if Clarkson had not persisted, we would have much less of a chance to agitate for human rights today. So, it is with all great movements. They must be preceded by agitation. In the present status of the Negro, it is particularly necessary that we today make the world realize what his position is, make them realize that he is not merely insisting on ornamental rights and neglecting plain duties, but that the rights we want are the rights that are necessary, inevitable, before we can rightly do our duties. Mrs. Gilman has a poem somewhere where she speaks of that rule which is to be laid down in a great future state. Unless a man works, he may not eat. And she says very aptly that the cart is before the horse because unless a man can eat, he cannot work. So to those people who are saying to black men today, do your duties first and then clamor for rights. We have a right to answer, and to answer insistently, that the rights we are clamoring for are those which will enable us to do our duties. That we cannot possibly be asked to do any partial measure of our duty even unless we have those rights and have them now. We realize this. The great mass of people in the United States do not realize it. Then what are we to do? We may sit in courteous and dumb, self-forgetting silence until other people are interested and come to our rescue. But it is reasonable to suppose that this is going to happen before degradation and destruction overtake us. This is a busy world. People are attending to their own affairs, as they ought to do. The man that has a grievance is supposed to speak for himself. No one can speak for him. No one knows the thing as well as he does. Therefore, it is reasonable to say that if the man does not complain, that is because he has no complaint. If a man does not express his needs, then it is because his needs are filled. And it has been our great mistake in the last decade that we have been silent and still and have not complained when it was our duty not to merely subject ourselves and our country to humanity in general, and to complain loudly. It is the high time that the Negro agitator should be in this land. It is not a pleasant role to play. It is not always pleasant to nice ears to hear a man ever coming with his dark facts and unpleasant conditions. Nevertheless, it is of the highest optimism to bring forward the dark side of any human picture. When a man does this, he says to the world, things are bad, but it is worthwhile to let the world know that things are bad in order so that they may become better. The real crushing pessimism takes hold of the world when people say things that are so bad that they are not worth complaining of because they cannot be made better. It is manifest that within the last year, the whole race in the United States has awakened to the fact that they have lost ground and must start complaining and complaining loudly. It is their business to complain. This complaint should be made with reasons and with strict regard to the truth, but nevertheless, it should be made. And it is interesting to find that even those persons who were deriding a complaint a few years ago joining in the agitation today. We of the Niagara Movement welcome them. We are glad of help from all sources. We are confirmed in our belief that if a man stand up and tell the things he wants and point out the evil around him, that this is the best way to be rid of it. May we not hope then that we are going to have in the next century a solid front on the part of colored people in the United States saying we want education for our children and we do not have it today in any large measure. We want full political rights and we have never had that. We want to be treated as human beings and we want those of our race who stand on the threshold and within the veil of crime to be treated not as beasts but as men who can be reformed or as children who can be prevented from going further into their career. If we all stand and demand this insistently, the nation must listen to the voices of 10 millions. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Michelle Biggenho. I am in sociology and anthropology, and I'm also connected to Africana and Latin American studies, particularly to the Latin American studies component. And I really appreciate following on Professor Simmons's words on agitation. I'm going to talk a little bit about some agitation that began in 1994 in southern Mexico, in Chiapas. But before that 1994 uprising that happened, which when it happened in Chiapas had a particular indigenous side to it, there were some young folks who were kind of trained in the kind of traditional leftist Marxist guerrillas, you know. And they marched off in the late 80s, early 90s to the jungles in Mexico. They themselves were mestizos, that's not indigenous in Mexico. And they thought they were going to sort of teach people to sort of, you know, raise their consciousness and, you know, bring them to the revolution. And they get to the countryside, they get to the jungle, and they find out that they actually have a lot to learn from the communities there. And so they began to sort of take a much more humble approach, learning from others, letting them sort of drive the movement. And if any of you have studied this as the Zapatistas, you may have heard of one of these particular mestizo figures, the subcomandante Marcos, or as they say, el sup. And I thought, well, sup at the coup? Well, el subcomandante. And he's sub because that's less than comandante. So he's trying to put himself in a more humble position. So a lot of the learning that El Sup learned from the folks in the communities in Chiapas came from a person that he refers to as El Viejo Antonio, an elderly man Antonio. And so I'm just going to read a very short story from that he heard from El Viejo Antonio. And I thought that this would be appropriate in sort of thinking about the current moment we're in and the kind of question of others and the kind of respect for others that's necessary and that we need to sort of learn to engage with otherness that we respect rather than expecting someone to become like ourselves. And I'm going to read this in Spanish. You can find translations online. This stuff is all very available. Zapatistas, EZLN, online in English translation too. But I wanted to also sort of bring that kind of different language in as well. And it's a story about the gods who are meeting and finding out that people are others, and those others need to be respected as such. And just keep in mind that the mestizo who's learning from El Viejo Antonio in this particular context, you know, he would come in with these kind of rational things, you know, like, well, we need to do this or that to mobilize. And El Viejo Antonio would respond with stories. So here's one of those stories about the others, La Historia de los Otros. Contaron los más viejos de los viejos que poblaron estas tierras, que los más grandes dioses, los que nacieron el mundo, no se pensaban parejo todos. O sea, que no tenían el mismo pensamiento, sino que cada quien tenía su propio pensamiento, y entre ellos se respetaban y se escuchaban. Dicen los más viejos de los viejos que de por sí así era, porque si no hubiera sido así, el mundo nunca se hubiera nacido, porque en la pura peleadera se hubiera pasado el tiempo los dioses primeros,
porque distinto era su pensamiento que sentían. Dicen los más viejos de los viejos que por eso era el mundo salió con muchos colores y formas, tantos como pensamientos habían en los más grandes dioses, los más primeros. 7 eran los dioses más grandes y 7 los pensamientos que cada uno se tenía. Y 7 veces 7 son las formas y colores con los que vistieron al mundo. Me dice el viejo Antonio que le preguntó a los viejos más viejos que cómo le hicieron los dioses primeros para ponerse de acuerdo y hablarse si es que eran tan distintos sus pensamientos que sentían. Los viejos más viejos le respondieron, me dice el viejo Antonio, que hubo una asamblea de los 7 dioses junto con sus 7 pensamientos distintos de cada uno, y que en esa asamblea sacaron el acuerdo. Dice el viejo Antonio que dijeron los viejos más viejos que esa asamblea de los dioses primeros, los que nacieron en el mundo, fue mucho tiempo antes del ayer, que mero fue el tiempo en que no había todavía tiempo. Y dijeron que en esa asamblea, cada uno de los dioses primeros dijo su palabra y todos dijeron, mi pensamiento que siento es diferente al de los otros. Y entonces quedaron callados los dioses, porque se dieron cuenta que cuando cada uno decía los otros, estaban hablando de otros diferentes. Después de que un rato se estuvieran callados, los dioses primeros se dieron cuenta que ya tenían un primer acuerdo y era que había otros y que esos otros eran diferentes del uno que era. Así que el primer acuerdo que tuvieron los dioses más primeros fue reconocer la diferencia y aceptar la existencia del otro. ¿Y qué remedio les quedaba si de por sí eran dioses todos, primeros todos, y se tenían que aceptar porque no había uno que fuera más o menos que los otros, sino que eran diferentes y así tenían que caminar? Después de ese primer acuerdo, siguió la discusión, porque una cosa es reconocer que hay otros diferentes y otra muy distinta es respetarlos. Así que un buen rato pasaron hablando y discutiendo de cómo cada uno era diferente de los otros. Y no les importó que tardaron en esta discusión porque de por sí no había todavía tiempo todavía. Después se callaron todos y cada uno habló de su diferencia y cada uno de los dioses se escuchaba, se dio cuenta que escuchando y conociendo las diferencias del otro, más y mejor se conocía y a sí mismo en lo que tenía de diferente. Entonces todos se pusieron muy contentos y se dieron a la bailadera y tardaron mucho, pero no les importó porque no, en ese tiempo todavía no había tiempo. Después de la bailadera se echaron los dioses, sacaron el acuerdo de que es bueno que haya otros que sean diferentes y que hay que escucharlos para sabernos a nosotros mismos. Y ya después de este acuerdo se fueron a dormir porque muy cansados estaban de haberse bailado tanto. De hablar no estaban cansados porque de por sí muy buenos eran para la habladera estos primeros dioses, los que nacieron el mundo y que apenas estaban aprendiendo a escuchar. Gracias.
I go by Akuya. Why you wanna fly, blackbird? You ain't ever gonna fly. Why you wanna fly, blackbird? You ain't ever gonna fly. No place big enough for holding all the tears you're gonna cry. 'Cause your mama's name was Lonely and your daddy's name was Pain. And they called you Little Sorrow, 'cause you'll never love again. You ain't got no one to hold you, you ain't got no one to care. If you'd only understand, dear, nobody wants you anywhere. So why you wanna fly, blackbird? You ain't ever gonna fly. This poem is about joy. It's not about water, remnants, evaporation, or sand, or thirst, or dry fruit, or hinges, or being hung. Today, no one died on the street, on the sidewalk, in the hands of a police officer or guard. Today, a little boy is able to play outside and be a child and with a full imagination. Today, the only time he was asked to put his hand up was to show us how he looks when he pretends he's flying. Today, a black woman could smoke a cigarette, could laugh, could do whatever the fuck she wanted to do with her hair. No one called me a nigger today, blatantly or indirectly. Today they remembered my name. Today it sounded like joy, no matter who said it. Today being black was not a reason to die by its natural causes. What I mean is, no one tried to kill me today. No one black or dark skin or the wrong shade died today. Today, the only time we came inside was to gather and tell stories. Remember when every day was a funeral, a sad song and a eulogy? Oh, but today, the only time we cried was when we rejoiced. The only hashtag we used today was joy. Today, the only handkerchiefs we used was to feel the faces of the ones who cried with joy. And this poem is about joy. It's not about fear or anger or sadness. Them emotions come to us too easy. This poem is not about glass or porcelain or fragile things or being weak or tired or broken or how many times, how long we gotta work for it. This poem is about joy, how long it stayed, how we remember it in us always. So I realize I'm also next again. That last poem was called, This Poem is About Joy by Ebony Stewart. And then this one is also by Ebony Stewart. Sorry, let me just find it. And it's called Compassion Fatigue. Just give me a second. To the white woman whose YouTube comment said she is tired of every poem being about race or rape, I'm not sure if compassion fatigue happens because no one taught you how to not be the oppressor or because no one taught you how to not be oppressed, but Your comment reminds us that no one cares about us but us. You're right. There are no new topics, just old problems written into new pleas to a country that refuses to reckon with its own sickness. We Americans, land of the free, can only keep our motto if we keep our mouths closed. And isn't that what all rapists want? Control and a silenced victim? Do you realize that someone had stopped listening to this poem because they say I am first black and also a woman? Black if I'm alive still, woman if I haven't disappeared yet, got anything anybody in the world might need except my voice, which means my body must be what's left for the taking. I'm not sure how we became treasures we can't afford to keep, but there are all kinds of women who have been raped, who still hoped their warm body's heart would stop beating, but still got up and went to work the next day. What we know is it's hard to comfort a girl that doesn't let on she's hurting. So praise every woman that speaks out against her rapist. Praise the ones who didn't but got their healing from the poems you are tired of hearing. How easy your life must be to only sit through the happy. While we try and believe, the only things we need to remember about suffering is that eventually it ends. 3 times now on social media, I've personally watched a black person be murdered because the United States is still making us pay for the way we look or the guilt it feels, but a person of color's only glory, hallelujah, is as long as we didn't die, then we didn't die. Do you realize that when our mothers say, I love you, she is also saying, stay alive. Come back to me whole, in one piece, and not another hashtag or another dead nigga's death that she'll have to watch on repeat. Us poets, whose duty is to write about the times, right? Because we don't know when we too will become extinct. Black ink from black poets who dare to write all about this black death instead of hiding behind everything we're thinking. How privileged your life must be that you can be tired of hearing poems about race or rape while we, the poets, write about an extinguished race and violated bodies that keep being raped. It's not hard to believe you're tired. But can you imagine how exhausted we, the poets, must be?
Hey. So I was a little nervous, but I'm glad everybody else went, because now could be a bit more candid. So I think I can't see these. This is I don't really have a name for this one yet, but I like it. I celebrated a friend's birthday this summer. There were 6 of us. 4 black kids, 2 white. We went to his apartment. We drank, we ate, we laughed, we danced around the fire. It was beautiful. It made me happy for the summer, for the future. We sat around a small fire pit and grilled steaks, chugged 40s, listened to music, and we shot cans with BB guns. And I felt the summer roll through the grass. We slept on blankets on the floor, too full or too happy to be uncomfortable. The next morning, cans still set up and heads still glitter-filled, the boys practiced their aim again. Civilians walked past and peeked in. Hamilton police drove by, and for a lot of reasons, my friends did not hide their weapons. For one, pride. They beat their chests and howled into the sunshine, testosterone and blood and black kraken flowed through their veins and made them invincible. Secondly, delusion. High off of life and mid-morning bong rips and friendship, they forgot who they were. They ignored the fear in our eyes and our voices because sometimes you just want to be someone else. Third, yeah, you can hide a plastic gun, but you can never take your skin off. No matter what, they were threats, so why not do a flip while you fall from the 10th story? I watched in amazement and horror because boys will be boys, but black boys will never just be boys. And as we all celebrated a birthday, I write a eulogy in my head. We talk them into going inside when the police drive by a second time, slower. They are still strong, still happy, but bullets are stronger and triggers are happier, and no hashtags or poems can wish back bullets. We went to Dunkin' Donuts and it was a distant memory. The bad taste in my mouth was washed away by glazed donuts and culottes. Later that night, I tried to write a poem about the magic that I had felt that night before. I tried to write a poem about love, about sadness, about sex, about fire, about friendship, school, summertime, God. I tried to prove to myself that I am a poet, an artist, not simply an anarchist bent on slaying the dragon that is whiteness. But am I? Am I anything more than a black girl? Hell, am I anything more than just black? Is this why people can't see me? Why people can't hear me? How can I expect people to see past my skin when I can't? I watched two black boys exist in pure euphoria. Two black boys yelled into the heavens and nobody called the police. Two black girls tilted their heads back to laugh and nobody threw dirty looks. And just like Hampo, it terrified me. Obviously, I know that those are different fears. I fear for my friends' well-beings, for their lives. White people fear for their own privilege, but for a moment, it saddened me to think that I wasn't so different than the dragons that I tried to slay. I'm sorry. I already got showed up, but I'll try anyway. Oh, say can you see by that black boy's death, over a mother's son's eyes, which are no longer gleaming. I am a citizen of the United States of America. I've been here my whole life, born and barcoded, but I'm from Albany, New York. I am from slang and ebonics. You wouldn't understand half the words coming out of my mouth if you went where I'm from. I am from fistfights in front of the libraries and stay on the right side in front of the halls or in front of the classrooms. Hall monitors are armed police officers, not students with orange vests where I'm from. I am from a school that is 90% minority. There are no Sarahs or Brads where I'm from. I've never seen so many redheads. I am from saggy True Religion jeans and size 13 foam. Sperry's and pastel shorts, they just don't happen where I'm from. I'm from metal detectors and bag checks before entering the building. Carrying two forms of ID just to get through the front door is normal where I'm from. I am from rhythm. Being able to dance is nothing to be proud of where I'm from. I am from gangs, YGs, Bloods, Crips. Hold your fingers the wrong way, wearing the wrong hoodie, wearing the wrong shoes. Might get you shot where I'm from. I am from guns in schools, four knives, one broken leg, and two stabbings in my senior year alone. You don't scare me because of where I'm from. I am from the womb of a black woman, the greatest honor to be had on this planet, but cherries and blue raspberry blow pop lights are a death sentence where I'm from. I am from the heart of black mothers before mine. Gold-plated badges are ninja throwing stars where I'm from. I am from the souls and hands of hard work. Jordans and gold chains are like nooses where I'm from. And the other day, my Irish friend asked me why I don't fuck with this country. And my first thought was, nigga, are you dead ass? Do you not remember that you used to be a nigga too because of where you're from? You have outgrown your oppression enough to ask me why I don't fuck with this country, and you have outgrown your oppression enough to not understand it when I say there is no way for me to fuck with a country that didn't fuck with me first, just because of where I'm from. Oh, say does that blood-soaked banner still wave over the land where I'm not free, where I have to be brave. And I've got one more. This is one of my favorites. You might have heard or read it before, but I'm still gonna do it. On April 23rd, 2016, at 9 p.m., Beyoncé released her sixth album, Lemonade. At the end of the fourth song, she sang the controversial and already infamous words, "You better call Becky with the good hair." And at that moment, this nation erupted. Becky was deemed a racial slur by white people nationwide. And I'm here to tell you that Becky is not a racial slur by any means. It is a stereotypical name for a white female, yes, but no, it is not a racial slur. But how I wish it was. I'll show you what it's like to be a stereotype, what it's like to walk down the street and have people rake their eyes up and down your body, eating without asking, asking without words, who are you? How did you get here? Where do you think you're going? Why are you here? What does it feel like to be a problem? In this new world with this new bad word, our values will change. There will be hair products dedicated to fixing Becky hair. There will be memes as far as the eye can see about Becky's and Chad's and stereotypical white things like Uggs and school shootings. Your children will cry and scream and paint their skin until they can look like their favorite princess, pardon me, their favorite queen in their favorite movie who they happen to notice never looks like them. You will wear butt pads because despite your best efforts, your Beckiness will always shine through, will always give you away, will never go away, no matter how much you try to hide it, no matter how much wet and wavy you sew into your scalp. And don't worry, you'll learn about weaves too. Beach waves and messy buns will be deemed unprofessional legally, and you will have to modify them for job interviews, and maybe even the whole time you work at the job. Your children will get kicked out of school for having hair too light or too straight, or their words were too clear, their ings too enunciated, their clothes too put together, their everything's too white. The other children can't see that. It'll be a distraction, a hindrance of learning. We're not even gonna be able to say it out loud. It will be whispered in the privacy of melanin, typed out as B*CKY on Twitter, except for those radical liberal pages that just write out the whole word. We will call them Rebecca's. It sounds so much harsher with the A, I know, and you will contour your skin to make your nose bigger, your skin darker, your cheeks less rosy, your face less like your face. And in 40 years, you guys will be saying Becca because you've reclaimed the word and it's okay to say now. And as long as your colored friends dye their hair or drink Starbucks or do yoga on Tuesdays, do they have their Becky cards? This is something that you'll have to discuss as a whole. I'm not gonna lie to you. It's a very, very difficult discussion, but I feel like you can get through it. People will ask you, you're a Becky? Like, only Becky? I mean, are you sure there's not like any LaQuanda in there? I mean, you're so pretty, I never would have guessed. You will watch your people's blood paint the sidewalks. And then, just when you're about to pull that trigger, there will be protests and rallies. Becky Lives Matter, they will shout through the streets. There will be Instagram pages dedicated to your struggle. Your college will finally assign an empty classroom somewhere to your meetings with people like you. And right when you begin to make progress, you will see organizations spring up out of thin air simply to combat any possible progress that you can make with people who look like you. non-Beckys will ask, only Beckys matter? All the names matter. What about Marias? What about Lings? What about Contagias? Not everything is about race, you know? Not everything is about skin color, you know? Not everything is about hair, you know? It's just hair. It's just hair. It's just your hair. Can I touch it? I mean, it looks so nice. I just want to, like, lay in it. This is just the beginning. You try to turn any bit of uncomfortability into oppression just to make yourself feel better. Becky, be careful what you wish for.
Lessons on being an African immigrant in America. One, lose your accent. People will make fun of the African girl, but nobody fucks with the black girls. Even when young, they can be so angry. Two, don't stare at white people. They're not animals in the zoo. Three, when they stare at you like an animal in the zoo, do not be confused. Do not bare teeth when they reach out to pet you, to touch your hair without permission. You are, after all, so exotic, so foreign, so other. Some will even call you inhuman. They will call you alien, ask you who called your spaceship to crash land your brain dreams into these eastern shores. These eastern shores have already landed ships from your world when we invaded it. But this is the 21st century and we don't need chains to make slaves of people anymore. Four, with a name like Mwende, Kolondu, Katwiwa, the jokes will come. Do not envy your brother David or blame your mother Lucy. The way their names roll smooth off foreign tongues is proof that colonization and assimilation go hand in hand. You are your grandmother's legacy. Five, when black people tell you you aren't really black, remind them how Amadou Diallo's dead body looked no different than any other black man in this gradual genocide. And I know you may not call it that in this country, but believe me when I say that we know what genocide looks like, know what it sounds like. It's white lies telling families that they are now enemies. We are identical twins that were separated at birth, now strangers. The hardest thing we will learn is to how to replant a family tree whose fruits were exploited for gain and whose branches held nooses. Six, when almost 300 of your West Coast kin go missing and America claims them as our girls, refrain from asking questions like, why did it take a month and a hashtag for them to claim family when it was in the news? Or why weren't the 60 schoolboys attacked by Boko Haram earlier this year claimed as our boys too? Instead, ask that they do not pony 2012 and these 234 to the backs of their browsers, that they not be the kind of family who only shows up to $12 weddings. Seven, when people ask you if you're upset because you're on your period the week Al-Shabaab attacks a mall in your home country, do not marvel at how some think blood only comes out of holes that the body has formed naturally. Eight, once you realize you can't stop your metamorphosis from the African girl to the American girl, every time you break free from Western cocoon and fly to your roots, resist the urge to remain pupa in the silk of stolen comforts. Brace for the turbulence that will shake your flight with the truth that you are no longer sure which place is home and which is foreign to you.
Escribo. Ella escribió. Que la memoria es frágil y el transcurso de una vida es muy breve. Y sucede todo tan deprisa que no alcanzamos a ver la relación entre los acontecimientos. No podemos medir la consecuencia de los actos. Creemos en la ficción del tiempo, en el presente, en el pasado y el futuro. Pero puede ser también que todo ocurra simultáneamente. Como decían las tres hermanas Mora, que eran capaces de ver el espacio, los espíritus de todas las épocas. Por eso mi abuela Clara escribía en sus cuadernos para ver las cosas con su dimensión real y para burlar a la mala memoria. Gracias.
Sorry, guys, I signed up for a lot of slots.
I wrote this on August 25th. I'm very random. I think in poetry, and then I like translate it into like, I mean, prose is poetry. That's why I like spoken word, because spoken word is literally how I talk. And sometimes I just write down what I'm thinking in my head. And then somebody would be like, oh my gosh, you're so poetic. And I'm like, okay. So I have to swallow the mic to get my point across. I have to enunciate with all of the power in me, because by instinct, I'm silent. By instinct, my voice doesn't matter. I don't matter. But I actively work to teach myself to check myself, to know my place. Because contrary to popular belief, contrary to the intentions of sexism or xenophobia or racism, all subcategories of white supremacy, my place is at the top. And I deserve to be at the top, as does everyone else. That was a poem. Here's another one. These are a series of unfinished poems and fake freestyles. I say that because I write them down just like the Kermit the Frog meme, like just fast. I get life from the sun. The sun that gives life to all of nature, makes me strong and healthy, gives me a mark of strength called melanin. Yet the symbol has become criminalized. We love to glorify everything light or white, everything loose or fallen. But remember to symbolize our features of physique to family. Let our coils be as tight as the bonds our ancestors hold. Let us not be so separate and sleek that we fall straight and parallel to our peers. Let our skin glow with the power of the sun. Let us grow so dark we shine, polished and beautiful, like the feet of Jesus. I'm gonna skip that poem. September 25th, written by 7:14 p.m. Sometimes I think black love don't exist. It's just a fallacy. Love is something from outside. It's just not in this galaxy. It's not of this time, you see. We too busy committing crimes against humanity. These lines that separate us, these lies that fate create us, skin color, genetic makeup, is God, the great creator, God. Nobody realized that God is a woman. Who else could love so sacrificially? Who else could choose a way to bring us from darkness to light? While we disappoint her for millennium, you see her plight? Okay, this one is Land of Snow. I told you I didn't finish them. Black niggas walk around talking about I want a snow bunny. Yeah, ever since they got to this campus, I seen them acting funny. Assimilation is the accusation that I charge them with, but I'm just some angry-ass black girl, just some jealous-ass bitch. I walk around in this land, this snow, this land is cold. Sometimes I think I gotta go. But even then, I find little love from my community. Black complacency, it's hard to find some unity, hard to find some truth, you see. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name it be. Him, I mean her it be, her who puts the wisdom in me. Loving us all the same and unconditionally. God is a woman, God is black, so what does that make me? Worthy, I'm worthy of everything, knowledge and power is mine. But the people are blind, for all have sinned and gone astray from glory divine. No one sees me right here, so they push me aside. October 25th, 2018, 8:49 p.m. I write these words to right my wrongs. My love is in these poems and my pain is in these songs. I used to talk a lot, but I never said much. Yeah, I did that shit on purpose. I was scared of getting caught up in emotions and connections because they addicting like drugs. Too expensive, so I use cheaper ones like physical touch. And I've been trying real hard to recover. But every so often I relapse with just another person who I get connected to. My hurt be undercover like the CIA. I forget it's there and I may just get lost in emotions that it feels like heart breaks when it ends, but it was all pretend. My heart was never fixed because I was misdiagnosed. Thought the problem was everyone else. It was really my innermost fear, a cancer that spread throughout my body till I had nothing but dread when I looked in the mirror. I'm trying to start seeing clearer, but it's hard when I'm nothing but a burning, dying star. Black complacency and the Black Icarus effect. I went to public school where we had fights like every day. Taught to hate each other, there was trouble every which way. Drive-bys, gang violence, no one to teach us to stay. Together for the sake of our people, we all went astray. From our community, we only think of ourselves. No wonder why we always living in hell. We want to be on top, but it's lonely when you go ahead and sell your soul to the devil, selling out for a Benzy. Don't worry about bills no more, but you always in a frenzy. Now look at all these people you left behind. You ignored God's calling, now here you are, blind. Can't even see where you went wrong, but look where we are. You traveled too far, you Icarus, too close to that star. And then the last one is this poem called Black Soldiers. That I performed at my old school. We did this thing called Umoja, and it means unity in Swahili. And so they wanted everybody to do something that they felt represented their culture. And because I'm Black, I felt like that was pretty accurate. This poem is called Black Soldiers. I wrote it. Before I start on this narrative, based off of my experience, I do want to acknowledge that there are people throughout this world and this community who are marginalized by others even today, who are forced to be hushed for the sake of unity. All I have to say is that everyone deserves the right to be themselves and comfortable with their identity. That should be the right that unifies us all. Black soldiers. Black soldiers march. Black soldiers fight for the people who will spit on them and tell them that they are nothing. Black soldiers built this country. Black soldiers built this world. Black soldiers had to fight and fight and fight and fight while they watched everyone else get a 400-year start. Black soldiers are forced to get over it because of 50 years of so-called action. Black soldiers. Black soldiers are told what to do. Black soldiers play a game of Simon Says, but nobody wins because Simon is the lieutenant of another nation. Black soldiers forget their nations. Black soldiers are told white lies that they are enemies. Black soldiers forget that their colonized and enslaved counterparts are identical twins separated at birth, now strangers. Now how do you replant a family tree whose fruits were exploited? Black soldiers forget that only 4.4% of their prisoners of war were sent to North America. Black soldiers forget that 93.8% went to the Caribbean and South America. Black soldiers are the only ones who try to empathize and understand others and accommodate for the people who will spit on them and tell them that they are nothing, black soldiers. Black soldiers want to be something until they are broken. But Simon told all the black soldiers to be like the people who broke them, or who are breaking them, or who will break them. Broken black soldiers take care of everyone else but themselves until they become tired. Broken black soldiers forget their name. Broken black soldiers want to be like the people who broke them. And because of this, when a black soldier is a black soldier, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier loves her skin, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier loves his hair, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier loves another black soldier, it's a revolutionary act. When a black soldier pops her gum, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier, when he talks like this, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier speaks, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier breathes, it is a revolutionary act. When a black soldier lives, when a black soldier lives, it is a revolutionary act. Black soldiers are revolutionary. Black soldiers are magic. But just because we are magic, it does not mean that we aren't real. Black soldiers have feelings. Black soldiers cry. Black soldiers are feminine. Black soldiers are masculine. Black soldiers are grown. Black soldiers smile. Black soldiers laugh. Black soldiers are children of God at heart. Black soldiers are loud. Black soldiers are bold. Black soldiers are timid. Black soldiers are vulnerable. Black soldiers are innocent. Black soldiers were made from the dust of this earth and will die as such. Black soldiers are beautiful. Black soldiers are black soldiers.